Well, hello and welcome everybody. It's lovely to continue broadcasting these services to you for each Sunday. We really hope that you're enjoying them and that they're keeping you spiritually refreshed and encouraged at this time of shutdown. I know that some of the home groups here at St. Peter's and some other groups of friends and members of our congregations are meeting together over Zoom, which is fantastic, online, and so do continue to do that. Please do remember those in our churches, though, and in our communities who are not online and therefore not able to meet in that way and not able to watch these services either. The best way to stay in touch with them is to pick up the phone, so please do that if you can. Rest assured, we are working hard to find ways in which, as soon as possible, we can then meet together as we were. But it doesn't look as though that's going to be quite some time away yet. And there will be spatial distancing measures in place for quite some time, even if we can meet together, either outside or inside. And no matter how long it takes before we can have something resembling a normal Sunday service, there will be members of our congregations who will feel, for very good reason, that they need to stay away for a fair bit longer. For that reason, at least, we will continue to post content online so that they can still be part of our worship from home. I hope all is well with you. The Weldons are all fine. Homeschooling carries on apace at the rectory, some good days, some more challenging days. I've been having some meetings with clergy online for various things. I've had one funeral in the last 5 weeks, two more in the pipeline. One of them is COVID related and the other one isn't. Jane is very busy at the medical centre, working her normal 3 days a week. The COVID situation, praise the Lord, remains relatively light here in the southwest, but lots of other regular GP work is now kind of coming back to the surgery. But it is manageable for her at the moment. Well, that's enough of the preamble, I think. I know lots of you wanted Emily to do another dance. Let's just say that takes quite a lot of planning, so not this time, I'm afraid. But there will be some music later on in our service after the prayers. Some readings as usual, and a third and final Easter message. So let's begin our service for this second Sunday after Easter. Do grab a Bible, and I'm going to hand over to Rita for our opening prayers.
It's good to be with you. We're going to begin with an opening prayer. We join together to worship a risen Lord. Be with us as we praise your name. We join together as people ready for what you have to tell us today. Give us hearts ready to respond to what we hear. We join together knowing that you are a loving, listening God. We ask that you will hear our prayers and accept all that we do in your name. Amen.
Amen.
And we have our prayer of confession. And the response for these are, forgive us and help us, loving Lord. Lord, as we travel the journey of life, sometimes we are sad and discouraged and don't recognise your presence. Forgive us and help us, loving Lord. As we travel through new experiences, sometimes we are confused and afraid and forget to look for you among the unfamiliar. Forgive us and help us, loving Lord. As we listen to people who have different ideas and views from our own, who challenge us and make us feel uncomfortable, we fail to see you at work in them. Forgive us and help us, loving Lord. Loving Lord, we humble ourselves before you. Forgive us our false pretenses, our prejudices, and our disregard for the world you created and for the people you give us to love and respect. Turn us away from the sins we have committed. Amend what we are and help us to walk with you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's have the first of our two readings this morning. And 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is one of the longest chapters in the New Testament. And there the Apostle Paul really sets out the implications and the meaning of the resurrection for us as Christians. So 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verses 50 to 58. I declare to you, brothers, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will all be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of the law, power of sin, is the law. But thanks be to God, he has given us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labour in the Lord is not in vain. Here ends the reading.
We're going to say Psalm 16 now, and that's verses 1 to 11. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge.
I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing.
I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight.
Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips.
Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure.
The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance.
I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me.
I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand I shall not be shaken.
Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure.
Because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful ones see decay.
You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. And our gospel reading is taken from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed, before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what he said in the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread.
Well, let's have a bit of a think about that reading that we heard read there. Very familiar, the road to Emmaus. And so I wonder what makes your heart burn within you. The medical condition heartburn is pretty unpleasant. It's caused by acid reflux, I gather. Now, I don't think I've ever had it, but I'm sure one day I will be reaching for the Gaviscon too. But the sensation those two men had on the road to Emmaus, well, it was obviously a wonderful one, not an unpleasant one in any way at all. They were thrilled at what Jesus had been telling them on the road, even if at the time they didn't realise that it was Jesus talking to them. And that's a curious thing about this story. Their eyes were opened to the reality of Christ later when he breaks the bread in front of them and he then vanishes from their sight. But it is their reaction on the road, when they were none the wiser as to who it was who was speaking to them, that seems to be the lasting impression on these two young men. That's what's noted here by Luke anyway. Were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us, they ask each other. Now, of course, they would have been delighted to realise later that it was Jesus who'd been with them all along, that he was alive. And so they rush back to Jerusalem and they tell the disciples the good news. They tell their story about how they recognised him at the breaking of the bread. But their initial reaction on realising that it had been Jesus speaking with them was to think back to how they felt while he was explaining the scriptures to them on the road, before they realised it was Jesus speaking to them. Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? That's the questions they ask each other. And I think that is the question the passage asks of us also. Perhaps that's why Luke has recorded it in this way. Do our hearts burn with the reality of the living God revealed to us in Jesus? Does your heart burn at the news of his truth revealed to us in the scriptures? Or do they burn with a passion for something else instead, perhaps? I guess if we were honest, we would say, well, yes, on a good day, my heart burns with a passion for God. When I understand the Bible, my heart leaps, or at least a bit anyway. When I see how bits of it fit together, or when I sense that, you know, that bit written in there was written as though it were just for me. Yes, on a good day, the reality of God, his presence with me, and the truth of his word, well, they make my heart sing. But often it's kind of the other way, isn't it? I know my heart should burn brightly for him. But like any kind of relationship, well, it kind of fizzles along, doesn't it, at times? My guess is at the moment, there will be some of you who will be finding your walk with Christ a bit of a trudge. The usual keep-me-ups of church fellowship and worship have largely gone. All the days seem to be slightly blending into one, don't they? Maybe you've experienced the opposite, though. Maybe actually this time of forced isolation has actually got you really fired up in your faith with extra time to think and read and pray. Maybe it's a bit of both, across a single day even. Well, those two on the road to Emmaus had a bit of an up and down day in their faith on that day on the road. By the end of the day, they were thrilled at the presence of the risen Christ. At the start, they had been discussing with one another what's been going on, you know, as you do, walking along a road. But it quickly becomes obvious to Jesus, as he walks up beside them, that they are sad and that they are downcast. They are confused by recent events. They had hoped that Jesus might have been the one to redeem Israel. And so they feel their hopes have been dashed because he was crucified and buried. But then on that Sunday morning, earlier on that very day, they're walking along the road to Emmaus. They've been hearing confusing reports that his body has gone missing. But so clouded by grief are they that they fail to spot, you know, the obvious answer to that conclusion, which, well, he must have been raised, surely. They needed the risen Jesus to set them on fire again. And that's exactly what he does. But he does it first by explaining the Bible to them. The scriptures, which they probably knew really well, but at that moment, the moment when it really mattered, they just couldn't see the significance of what they knew. That's a very common human reaction in grief. And so Jesus sets about setting their hearts ablaze with hope and light and truth from his word. Later, he would also do it with a sign, the breaking of bread. But it's word before sign on the road to Emmaus. And as someone who loves the word of God, that gets me very excited, because it means that you and I, all these years later, with the same word open in front of us, but with no prospect of physically walking along a road with Jesus quite like those men did, we can nevertheless, just as much as they did, have hearts burning within us with the reality of the living God, because we have the same word as they did. In fact, actually more so, because we have the New Testament as well as the Old. Now, I'm sure Jesus' Old Testament overview on the road to Emmaus was pretty awesome. The way he summarized Moses and the prophets, that shorthand for really the whole of the Old Testament, the first five books of the Old Testament, and all the books of prophecy. I bet the way he summarized it was awesome, knocking every great Bible teacher off their perch. George Whitfield, Martin Lloyd-Jones, John Stott, Billy Graham, eat your heart out. And they would happily, I'm sure. Because this is the Son of God on the road to Emmaus, showing the good news of God from the Word of God. And the truth is that we can have the same today. We can have him doing the same for us today, so that our hearts might burn with a passion for God too. Whether it is live here in church, whether it is online as you're watching now, or whether it's reading the Bible for ourselves, we have the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus, showing us the good news of God from the Word of God. And the particular aspect of his good news that we celebrate at this time of year is, of course, that Jesus is alive. Sin and death have been defeated. The way to eternity has been opened. And therefore, we have hope. Because of Easter, there is always hope. So what makes your heart burn within you? We'll probably all have a different answer to that question. The chance to meet family and friends again. Well, that will make my heart sing. But supremely, it is the news of a risen Saviour that changes hearts, that sets them on fire with love for God again. News that is ours today, because it is here in plain sight. We can read it for ourselves. If Jesus thought the Bible was true, true enough to open it up and explain it on the road to Emmaus to those men, if he thought it was true, well, then it must be true. Amen.
We're going to spend some time in prayer now. When I say, Lord, hear us, please respond with, Lord, graciously hear us. And first a prayer for St. George's Day, the patron saint of England, which was last Thursday. Heavenly Father, give us the bravery of St. George to stand up for the truth and the glory of God that we have seen in the face of Jesus Christ. Give us the strength to overcome in our lives and in the world or that is contrary to your rule of justice and love. Help us to be good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind. Let the oppressed go free and proclaim the good news of God's favour and jubilee. Amen. God of love and hope, you made the world and care for all creation, but the world feels strange right now. The news is full of stories about coronavirus. Some people are worried that they might get ill. Others are anxious for their family and friends. Be with them and help them to find peace. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for the doctors and nurses and scientists and all who are working to discover the right medicines to help those who are ill. Thank you that even in these anxious times, you are with us. Help us to put our trust in you and keep us safe. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For those who are guiding our nation at this time and shaping national policies, that they may make wise decisions, Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For the vulnerable and the fearful, for the gravely ill and the dying, that they may know your comfort and peace. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For the isolated and housebound, that we may be alert to their needs and care for them in their vulnerability. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For our homes and families, our schools and young people, for our farmers, and all in any kind of need or distress. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For a blessing on our local community, that our neighbourhoods may be places of trust and friendship, where all are known and cared for. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. final prayer. May God's blessing be with us, a blessing from the one who never deserts us, a blessing for life in all times, in all places, a blessing from our gracious God. Amen.